Hello, my friends. Chris Cooking Nashville here. It is a health vlog. Really interesting week. And, you know, I've talked about this in previous health vlogs before, but sometimes I have this reaction where I feel like I am oxalate dumping, where I feel like some of the symptoms that I have from previous, you know, health issues from when I was not on a carnivore diet, they tend to return. Not super bad, but they do tend to return for a few days. And this time around, it was like IBS a little bit. Headaches, migraine headaches, couple of nights in a row, couple of days in a row, just not sleeping well and headaches, not feeling, you know, super great. And I sort of chalked it up to not getting enough sleep. But regardless, that is something that I used to deal with sort of randomly. You know, I would wake up and have absolutely no idea why, but I would just have headaches and, you know, pre-keto and carnivore. And I really think that a lot of that had to do with the diet and oxalates in the diet and the different things I was dealing with. I haven't really had migraine headaches in months. Like, even if I have, you know, a little bit of a headache, like I haven't slept really right, or you know, maybe like my neck is stiff because I slept wrong, or I've, you know, had stress that has turned into something. Usually the headaches don't turn into too awful much. A lot of times if I was dealing with headaches, I was sort of associating them with like allergies. Regardless, I had some really crazy migraine headache stuff. The first night actually woke me up. It was hurting so bad. The next night I didn't wake up in the middle of the night or anything, but I woke up yesterday with a little bit of a headache. So, that being said, when I got on scale, it was 257.8. So prior to that, the lowest I saw was 258.1. Now 257.8. 257.7, it was right there. I forget which one, because I weighed multiple times to make sure that I was getting an accurate reading, and it was, you know, right there. So under 258. Let's not forget, at the beginning of my whole carnivore keto journey, like everything that I've done with low carb, the highest weight that I saw for sure was 385. I was probably bigger than that at some point, because I have some pictures of when I was probably bigger than 385. And I just didn't weigh myself there for a long time because it was too depressing to think about what I weighed. And there was a lot of mental stuff going on with the diet and just all sorts of problems. So 385 down to 258. So 258, 257 point something, about 258. Basically means I'm in the range of like 126 pounds of weight loss. 126 pounds. Of weight loss. If you guys go back in my health vlogs, you'll remember I was celebrating losing over 100 pounds. That's another 26 pounds since then. I'm still losing weight. Y'all, if you change your diet, if you eat keto, ketovore, carnivore, whatever works best for your body, and if you are patient with your body, it will respond. Now, I think one of the big issues that a lot of people really struggle with is they say, you know, my weight loss has stalled. And I'm not saying that there aren't people whose weight loss stalls. Absolutely there are. But there's a couple of things that you have to really be objective with yourself when you ask. First of all, and this I would say is probably one of the most common things, is people that say, I've done keto, I've done carnivore, I'm not losing any weight, whatever. I actually had a family member who told me this, and they tried keto and they didn't lose any weight. Generally, if you are doing this, not losing any weight, even if you feel like it's a stall, or especially if you started at the beginning and you're not losing weight, a lot of times it's because you think you're doing keto or carnivore and you're not. Like, I'm sorry, but I've had people say, I'm doing carnivore, and then I ask them like what they're having, and it's like, well, I'm having like meat and eggs and blah, 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 blah. And then they start saying, and you know, at night I let myself have a little bit of fruit. And then, you know, I use ketchup on this thing. And, you know, I have a little bit of this, and I still have like one Coke a day. I mean, they start listing off stuff, and I'm like, you're not even close to doing low carb, let alone carnivore. That's a problem. We have to be objective. Are you truly, truly doing keto, ketovore, carnivore? And, you know, I'll be the first to admit, when I do carnivore, there are people out there that flip out that I'm using seasonings and that I have maybe more dairy than some carnivores do, because that can't possibly be carnivore. You want to split hairs and say like seasonings aren't carnivore, whatever. Great. So I do carnivore plus some seasonings and dairy, I guess, you know, whatever. Generally speaking, that works really well for me, and that's carnivore enough for my personal diet. You know, like seasonings, you don't want to do dairy, don't eat that stuff, right? I'm not here to tell you you have to do it my way. I'm here to tell you, here's what I'm doing and here's recipes that work for it. If that works for you, great. So you have to be objective with yourself, though. Are you actually cutting your carb content the way you think you are? It is so easy for carbs to sneak in. The second thing you have to really think about is, you know, especially if it's a weight stall, are you being patient with your body? Are you recognizing that your body needs time to heal because you did not get overweight and sick in a month? You did it over a period of decades, usually. So if that's the case, why do you think that you're going to recognize all of this stuff healing in a linear way, losing weight in a linear way over just week by week by week progression? Just because you're not losing weight doesn't mean your body's not doing things that are good for you. I had to really wrap my mind around this when I did this the very first time, but it's something we have to come to grips with. Like, we took a long time to ruin our bodies to the point where we are. It might take a long time to get our bodies back to an ultimate form of health, and we have to experiment along the way and figure out what that means. We're in almost in December. This is the end of November. We're almost in December, and in January, beginning of January, it will be my carniversary, my 365-day carniversary. Now, that is carnivore with no cheats. Again, I have some spices. I have, you know, more dairy than some people consider carnivore, whatever. I am not a meat, saltwater carnivore. I am a carnivore plus spices and dairy, as long as they don't bother me, and coffee. Once I hit my 365 days, I may experiment a little bit with more things on the ketovore side of things, just because I want to know for my own sake. Once I've done all of this and I've healed this much for a year, what do things like a little bit of onion, a little bit of peppers, a little bit of tomato maybe, things that you would use to season things, like, what is that going to do to my body? Is that going to significantly stall my weight loss? Is that going to make symptoms return? Is that going to cause gut issues? Like, what is that going to do? And if you are one of those people who's like meat, saltwater carnivore, and that's the only way and whatever, great. I don't need to hear about it in the comments section. That's what you think I should do. The majority of you are fantastic, but there's a handful of people out there that still like to get on a soapbox. And I'm not saying what you're doing is wrong. I'm not even saying that you're not making a good point, depending on what you're saying and, you know, what your point is you're making. Maybe you're right. But it is my prerogative in my life to be able to test things and to try to experiment and figure out what the ultimate version of how I can feel and how I can eat and how I can be stable is for me. And I would encourage each of you to do that. And that's something that I think sometimes we have to remember. No one has the right to tell you how you have to eat. I can encourage you all day long to try what I think is right and to try what has worked for me, but I have to understand that is not the same thing as ordering you what you should do or telling you I know what's going to be best for you because whatever. So if you want to experiment and you want to try a little more dairy, you want to try dairy-free, you want to try having coffee, you want to try no coffee, you want to try these spices, you want to try no spices, you want to try tomatoes, no tomatoes, you want to go some nightshades, you want to do no nightshades, you do whatever it is that you want to try. Be disciplined and be objective enough to give yourself true results. Understand those results and accept those results and make good choices for yourself, for your life, both your physical and mental health as a result of that. But understand you are in control. It is your diet, it is your life, it is your choice, and you need to do what it is best for you. Now, something that goes along with that is that objective discipline. We have to do the research, we have to do the experiments, we have to do it the right way. You can't go carnivore for 3 days and say, well, it doesn't work for me. Your body does not react that way. 30, 60, 90 days, that's an experiment. That is giving yourself time to see if it works. And if it doesn't work or it doesn't make you happy, it doesn't make you feel good, and you're like, no, I can't do this, I totally get that. If you go meat, saltwater carnivore, and then you want to start incorporating some things and say, okay, I'm going to incorporate and see if garlic bothers me. Smart experiment. But if you have garlic one day, and then the next day you have onions, and then the next day you have some peppers, and then the next day you have some tomatoes and some eggplant, and then the next day you, Like, you see where I'm going with this. If you keep stacking things on top of each other, and then suddenly something bothers you, and you say, oh, I can't possibly have any of this, because it just makes me sick, and it does this, and it does that. Maybe, but maybe not. You don't really know. So when you do this, you have to be disciplined and regimented enough to actually garner information from what that data says for you. And continue doing your research, continue doing the work to find out what works and what doesn't for you. That's a really great thing to do. Be careful, though, that you don't fall into the trap of believing that because somebody else says this worked great for me, that it's going to work the same exact way for you. And definitely don't fall into the trap of, well, this works for me, so obviously it'll work for everybody else. So I'm going to go online and I'm going to tell everybody, you have to do this, you have to do that. And if you don't do it that way, you're not doing it right. You're not a real carnivore. You're not really keto. You're not. It's crazy. Do the research and do the experimentation with the actual data and give yourself time and have patience, and you will learn so much about your body and how you respond to certain foods and what makes you feel the best. And that's what you got to do. That's what I'm going to do. And it's not because I feel like, oh, I'm craving things and I have to, you know, incorporate these things in my life, or it's just not okay. That is not the case. Food is not something that I just have to have like a drug anymore. I have beaten that food addiction, those cravings, whatever. But I am also fully aware of the fact that they could return. So if I eat something and within a day or two or three or five or whatever, suddenly I'm craving foods and I'm like jonesing for something because there were some plant carbs in something, I'm going to recognize that. I'm going to have to say, okay, that's not good. That fires up that whole food addiction, because that is not something I want to go back to. I do not want to be in a position sitting in the middle of the night trying to go to bed and craving food to a point where I can't sleep because I have to feed the addiction. I've been there. I don't want to binge eat on things because I just can't stuff myself with enough of whatever the sugar or grain or chemical or whatever kind of food is. I remember sitting down when I was in college and even after college and doing things like eating an entire box of Twinkies at one time. Or I would go to cake sections at like grocery stores and get a cake or cheesecake or something because I was just craving it. And I would take that home and I would sit there and I would eat as much of it as I wanted until I was just too sick of sugar to be able to eat anymore. More than once I sat down and ate an entire cheesecake. That's kind of embarrassing to even talk about, really. But that's the truth. That is something that I have done. I used to go to Taco Bell and spend between $20 and $25. I would have a massive amount of food. So I'll just tell you guys, like, this might be interesting for you. This is what my standard Taco Bell order was when I was in college. Two Mexican pizzas, and I would get the combo thing that came with tacos as well. So I would get two Mexican pizzas and four tacos with sour cream. I would have a steak quesadilla, usually two or three orders of cheesy fiesta potatoes. Very frequently, I would get some kind of Baja Gordita Crunch or something similar. I would get cheesy potato burritos, the beef and potato and cheese burritos. I'd get, you know, maybe like two of those. Sometimes more, sometimes less food-wise, but that was generally around what I was doing, which is a stupid amount of food. And on top of that, I would get two extra large Mountain Dews, easy on the ice, so I would get more Mountain Dew. And I would go back to my dorm room, or I would go back to my apartment after I graduated college. I would sit down at like 1 in the morning, eat all of that food, drink both of those Mountain Dews, and lay down and go to bed. That's the level of food addiction that I would have. And that wasn't necessarily dinner. Sometimes that was dinner. Sometimes that was the 1 a.m. I've eaten dinner at 5 or 6 o'clock, and now I'm hungry at 1 a.m. and I need food to satisfy that addiction. I mean, we're talking about like mid-2000s prices at Taco Bell. Fast food has gotten ridiculous in the current economy, so I don't even know what that would cost me now. I'm talking like in mid-2000s, like 2007, 2008, right, later 2000s, I guess, that time period, $20 to $25 worth of Taco Bell. That makes me sick to even think about what I was doing to my body. I can tell you so many stories of things that I ate or drank just at a level that is beyond harmful. When I talk about understanding food addiction, I am not kidding. Like, I mean, I binged on things badly. And there's a reason that I got to be almost 400 pounds. Maybe I was over 400 pounds. I don't know. But what I do know is that carnivore, keto too, but especially carnivore, has saved my life. I'm not saying that carnivore is going to do that for everybody, but I do think that carnivore seems to be the best option for the most people, just based on my own observations and the research I've done. I'm not a doctor, I'm not a scientist, I can't tell you all of the ins and outs, but the stuff that I have researched and the studies that I've read and the people that I follow who I think really put information out there about this kind of stuff that actually can be backed up by science. Also, just the experience I've had inside my own body, I do think carnivore is kind of the ultimate place to try to go. I also think keto can work really well, and maybe you can get ultimate health from keto for you personally. Maybe I can have some things like some onions and peppers and it's not going to harm me. Maybe it will really drive food cravings, or maybe it will cause an addiction, you know, issue for me, or I don't know. But see, that's the problem. I don't know. Once I hit my 365 days, that was my goal. I didn't start out with that goal, but as I began my YouTube channel and as I started doing these health vlogs and stuff, I was like, I want to go a full 365 days. No cheat meals, keto meals, definitely no like sugar processed, any of that kind of stuff. None of that. And that's with us being on tour, vacation, being away from the house, us going out to dinner. Like, that's me being very careful that the only thing I've had that's not true 100% carnivore is some spices and maybe a little dairy that by some people's definition, it's too far on the dairy. And I wanted to hit that 365-day goal, one, to prove to myself that I could do it, because you really need to be able to take these kinds of things and prove to yourself that you have the strength to do it. Not because if you don't do it, that makes you less valuable, but because if you don't, you're always going to question if you can. So sometimes you got to grit your teeth and get through it so that you can prove to yourself that you are strong enough and you are worth that. For me personally, that was something I needed to do. That's good. That's cool. I'm going to make that 365-day thing no problem. And at this point, it's just a habit. It's not even a question. But once I do that, you know, since I can share that with you guys here, and hopefully that's inspiring to some of you that like, hey, Chris dealt with this food addiction and these, you know, massive like weight gains and all these health problems and depression and anxiety and all of this stuff. Look how many things he's healed, and he was able to do this. And even in the midst of stress and working four jobs and running the YouTube channel and all of this kind of stuff, like in the midst of all of this, he was able to make it work for 365 days. I can do it. I don't have to give in to those cravings, because he's showing you that it can be done. And that's not to say that if you fail at this, or you fall off the wagon, or you have something you shouldn't, it's not to say there's anything wrong with you, or that you're not good enough, or you're not as good as me. There is no judgment in any of this. Simply there for the inspiration and for the example of it can be done. If you do the work to try to make it work in your own life, if I can do it, you can absolutely do it. So don't be afraid of it and go after it and chase what it is you're trying to do with it. But you need to be able to experiment to figure out what makes you feel the best, and you need to be smart about it. Once you've proven these things to yourself, don't become dogmatic and don't become theological about this. Like, this is not a religion. This is a science experiment inside of your body, and it's about how you feel and what makes you the healthiest. We're still fumbling around in the dark, as Dr. Barry always says. We're trying to figure out keto, carnivore. What's the long term for some of these things? What's the ultimate way of doing this? Is there an ultimate way of doing this? Is there 5 different ultimate ways? Is there 100 ultimate ways? Like, we're still learning about this. And we have to fight political and cultural things in the process. I mean, there's so much out there that affects this. This is murky water, and we're trying to swim through it and find a pebble at the bottom of the mucky lake. Who knows where it is? And we're searching for it. So we have to just keep feeling around and try to do the best we can for ourselves. That's why I'm here. I'm here to inspire you guys as best I know how. I'm here to give you recipes that can be used as tools, so that if you feel like, I want to stay carnivore, man, I wish I could have pizza night with the family while we watch the football game, because that's an important ritual, because there is a cultural and mental aspect, there is a philosophical element to your diet, and you cannot ignore that it exists. I hear all the time, food is not entertainment, food is fuel, and I agree with that. But culture is entertainment. Sometimes it is filled with entertainment. And culture and food are very closely tied together, because that's part of what has made us as human beings into the race, the society that we are. You cannot ignore the cultural implications of your diet, because if you do, you set yourself up to fail. Now, I'm not saying you have to give in to that and that you have to conform to what everyone else's cultural expectations are. That's a case-by-case basis. You have to figure out what can you do for your own mental well-being, for your own cultural situation, your circumstances, what can you do to be at the ultimate health? So if you figure out what makes you feel the best and you figure out how that fits in culturally with your family, with your friends, with the things you do, you try to inspire them to be healthier. Like, see what I'm saying? This is a holistic approach to keto and carnivore and these recipes. These recipes are tools. You choose to use them how they work best for your diet and for your body and for your cultural, familial, psychological experience, the bubble that you live in and what surrounds you and what is a part of that in your life where you live with the people that you know and the people that you love. How does this work? That's what you have to be able to do. And that's why I want to experiment, because I want to know, what does my body do? How do I feel the best? And then how does that apply to the culture that exists around me? I'm a full-time musician on top of the other jobs that I have. I'm a full-time musician. When you're at a bar, because you're playing a show and everyone in the audience wants to like buy you a shot, buy you a beer, like buy you all these kinds of things. It's like, I don't drink alcohol. I have to understand culturally how to deal with that situation. What I usually do is I have some kind of glass, soda water, lime. And if somebody says, hey, I'd love to buy you a shot, I'd love to buy you a beer or whatever, I hold my glass. I go, oh, I'm good. I really, really appreciate it. And if they're really, oh no, come on, please let me get you something. I'll be like, you know, I'm good. I'm done. But I'll take a soda water. If you really want to feel like you're helping out, like that's cool. I appreciate that, a soda water, but I really don't want anything else. Like I'm good. Usually one of those two answers suffices for people and that's fine. And if I really have to, if someone was really pushing, I would say something like, you know, I appreciate it, but I actually don't drink anymore. Addiction runs really deep in both sides of my family. That usually shuts that down right away. I don't go straight for that because I don't want people to feel bad if they're, you know, trying to do something nice for me and, you know, think that like maybe I'm one step away from being, you know, addicted to alcohol or something, because I'm good. That is not where my addiction lies. My addiction lies in food, soda, and things like that. But addiction runs very deep in my family on both sides, and alcoholism specifically. I've always very much steered clear of, you know, the whole alcohol thing. Ash is the same way. You know, my wife is a very disciplined woman and has realized genetically for her, alcohol does not make her feel good. And I mean, she had one drink after not having one for, gosh, like almost a year probably. She had one drink and it messed with her head for over a week. And it was like, she won't do it anymore. You know, it's just like genetically there's something about her that she's like, nope, that is not good for me. And that fits really well with, you know, a keto and carnivore lifestyle that we live. So I don't want people to feel bad, so I don't go straight to that. But if I need to, like if I really need to put my foot down, I can do that if I have to. But that's a cultural way of maneuvering through this expectation of keto and carnivore and how that compares to the typical cultural expectation of food, drink. You have to be able to do those things. You have to have some kind of a plan of action. I have a health vlog where I said plan ahead for these kinds of things, right? You pregame, or you know what you're going to get into if you go to a restaurant with friends, what you're going to order. Like you either eat ahead of time or you have a plan going in so you don't end up in a spot where you're like, well, now I have no plan and now I'm hungry and then I give in. This is the same idea. So these recipes are tools that help you with that. So it's like, hey, I'm going to go have pizza night with the guys. We had some friends over for dinner. The guy that came over and his wife, like he's into carnivore now. He hasn't done it as long as I have, but he's into carnivore. Super deep, super strong, but he's just like, man, I just wish I had a little more variety. Like I've done this a while now, I feel amazing. But on the rare occasion, I want something more, it would just be cool. And so they wanted to try some of my carnivore stuff. So I made carnivore pizza. First time I've done it in months. And he loved it. And he was like, this is amazing. And he was asking me about like why I run the YouTube channel and why I do this stuff and like talking about the ins and outs of my recipes and my goals and all this. It was a great conversation. It was amazing to have that kind of connection with somebody in person like that to be able to talk about this stuff. And I said, the implication of this goes so much deeper than in a carnivore pizza. Imagine you're going over to some friend's house for a football game and you have this tradition where you guys always order pizza and you sit around and have pizza and you have beer and you watch the football game and chat and, you know, whatever. Like just as an example, let's say you do that. Now you make a carnivore pizza, you take it with you and you say, hey guys, don't order any pizza from me. You sit down and you go, yeah, I'm doing this diet thing. Like it makes me feel so much better. And this is a pizza that's, you know, know, like low carb. Like, you don't have to use the word carnivore. You just go, this is a low carb pizza, but it's really great. I feel so much better this way. Like, and make an extra one and be like, you guys want to try it? It's really good. You can go ahead and get your pizza, but I've got my pizza and brought one that you guys could try it if you want and just kind of see what I'm doing. Now, not only can you have pizza night with the guys, you don't make a big deal out of it, and they're totally cool with it for generally. I mean, if you feel great and it's helping you for health reasons, people are oftentimes very supportive of that if you just explain it that way. And now you're actually showing them that the health things that you're doing for yourself can actually taste pretty good. You might actually have a positive effect in someone else's life too. That's a really, really cool cultural implication of a carnivore pizza. So this is why when people say you're not a real carnivore, real carnivores don't use recipes and any of the other dogmatic junk, that is a perspective that they are completely unaware of. And it's a really important perspective, I think, because there are people who are never going to be in a position to be meat, salt, water, true carnivores. And even if the meat, salt, water thing is the ultimate way of doing this, that doesn't mean that people are ready to do it all the time. If you put someone in a situation that stresses them out so much that they can never succeed, and then you judge them for not succeeding, that was never about you helping them in the first place. I've told numbers of stories about this kind of stuff, about, you know, like a lady that contacted me and said her child with autism doesn't like carnivore foods or keto foods, and they don't process things the way we do. And so if you try to feed them something that is a low carb substitute, which would be very good for their health and their mental health, even as someone with autism, like, that's good for the firing of the brain stuff, right? Like, that's like, even you're not going to cure autism with it, that's not what I'm saying, but you can improve the life that they have. You can improve their brain function on whatever level their particular diagnosis will allow. You can make their life better. But because they don't process things the way we do, they eat something, the texture's wrong, they throw it across the room, they can't stand that, and then, you know, they have whatever their reaction is, whatever their trigger is, causes them to act in a way that none of the rest of us who don't deal with that same thing can understand. But then they made my carnivore pizza, and their child ate the whole thing and never questioned it, and they said they just had pizza, which is one of their favorite things, but now they had a lower carb version of it. They didn't even question it. So because that person can't do meat, salt, water, only carnivore, because as someone with autism, they can't really understand maybe that concept. They can't think through the idea of, I'm going to discipline myself to have meat, salt, water because it's going to make my life better, right? Someone like that, do they not deserve better health because they can't process that same thought in the way that someone who says you're not a true carnivore would tell them that they should? I think that's pretty heartless, and that seems to be pretty much about, let me elevate myself and make myself feel good rather than let me help the world. There's a lot of cultural implications to why we do the things that we do and why I make the recipes that I make, and it goes way beyond just the idea that I can't give up trigger foods. It's not about giving up trigger foods. I've done meat, salt, water. I can do that. I just don't like it. Doesn't mean that it's maybe not the ultimate for me. I don't know if it is. I don't necessarily think that I felt better doing meat, salt, water than I do doing carnivore the way I do it now. That's why I'm going to experiment and see, well, if I go a little the other direction, like, how far do I go before I don't feel good anymore? And how long does it take? And what are the health implications of that? I need to know all of that for myself. And I need to know that so I can communicate with you guys what I'm doing, so you can keep watching the channel and hopefully get some inspiration about how you can do it for yourself too. There's a lot of implications to why these things matter, and I just do this stuff because I want to be real, raw, and honest with you guys about what it is like to do this and where I succeed and where I fail. Lately, I feel like I'm succeeding in a lot of places. I'm really happy about it. I hope that that is inspiring to you. I hope that my weight loss of 126 pounds maybe gives you a moment to think, I can do this too. Nothing special about me that I'm somehow out at, you know, one of those guys at the gym that's like getting ripped and getting a six pack, and I work out 12 hours a day because I just love the gym. I am not that guy. I hate going to the gym. I hate exercise. I love playing, but I haven't felt physically well enough to do it in so long. I don't even know where I'd begin at this point, but I'd love to be able to do that. One of the biggest driving forces for me getting healthy is I hope someday I get a chance to be a dad. If that's in the cards and that's part of God's plan for my life, great. I'll be a dad, and I'll do the very best that I know how to do it being a dad. I'm not in a position right now for us to be able to do that and have that be a smart decision. Ash and I may decide we want to have kids eventually, and if we do, I don't want to be sitting on the couch miserable watching my kids through the window play outside because I can't go with them. I want to go outside and play with my kids if I have them, and I want to be able to take my wife on adventures and not have her looking for a bench for me to sit and rest because my feet and my knees and my back all hurt. I've done that. Let me tell you, it makes you feel like a failure and a worthless man when your wife has to look for the next bench for you to sit on so that you can rest because your feet hurt and you can't do the fun thing that she asked you to go do that day with her. There was more than once I looked in the mirror and I hated myself because I felt like I was holding my own wife back from the great life that I wanted her to have. Now she has a hard time keeping up with me when we go places. She's made that statement, and it's funny, we've gone places and she goes, "Do you need to sit down? Do you need to rest? Like, I know we've been walking a long time," and she's still so in the habit of worrying about whether I feel good or not, because my wife is just a wonderful, amazing woman who just puts everyone's needs before her own, including mine. But she'll ask me those questions because she's so much in the habit of worrying about my back, my feet, my knees, my neck, my, you know, all of the things of pain because of all of the weight I was carrying. And she says it, and I'm always like, "No, I'm good. Let's go." I have so much more energy. She's always like, "Okay." And we were at Dollywood, and she sat down. She's like, "Hang on a minute. I need to sit down for a second." I was like, "All right, cool." We sat down, and now, to be fair, she drank a lemonade, and, you know, she doesn't normally do stuff like that, but on vacation, she does not deal with sugar addiction and food addiction the way that I do. So when we're places on vacation like that, she might occasionally have something like a frozen lemonade, or she might have potatoes with her dinner, or, you know, things like that, because she can have stuff like that. She doesn't feel good maybe the next day or two, but she can go right back to what she's doing, and then she feels fine, and, you know, it doesn't trigger anything for her. So for her, again, ultimate thing for each individual person, she's done that experimentation, and she realizes she can do that. So she'd have something like a lemonade, and you could tell the sugar, like, it would hit her, and all of a sudden she's like, "Okay, I need to sit down for a minute. Like, I'm whole. Oh, okay. Too much sugar. Can't do that again today." But I have the energy now that when she asks me those questions, it's always like, "No, I'm good. Let's go take the dog for a walk. Let's, you know, go walk further. Like, it's all the way on the other side of Dollywood. Are you sure you want to walk all the way across the park? Like, are you good?" And, you know, "I'm good." So there's just things like that where she, you know, sometimes has to keep up with me now. So I'm not holding my own wife back from the adventurous life and the beautiful things that I want her to be able to have. And I don't feel like a failure as a man who is trying to take care of my wife and be her partner and give her the most amazing life that I can help be part of providing for her and do those things, and then feel like I'm too sick and fat to be worthy of the person she is, and too sick and too fat to be able to do the great things that I think she deserves to have in her life to go on those adventures with her. I'm not the lead weight holding her back like I once felt like I was. That's what losing 126 pounds and finding a new life because of keto and carnivore will do for you, at least in my experience. I can't say how exactly it'll play out in your life and what effects you'll see, but I'm telling you, there's a lot of indication that this is the way to do it, and I would encourage anyone and everyone to try it, and really try it, not do it for a day and, like, "Okay, well, that works." No, like, really try it. Really give it a good, honest 30, 60, ideally 90 days. Just see what happens and see if you feel better. If you do it for 90 days, 120 days, whatever, and you're like, "No, I feel even worse and I have all these health issues and whatever, nothing's any better," like, okay, I can't say as I would blame you if you would decide not to continue. But if you did it, and you really did it, and suddenly 30, 60, 90 days later, you found a brand new life and you found a path that you could start walking day by day and improving it a little at a time, using tools like recipes that keep you stable in it. And over a period of time, you started becoming, instead of the lead weight that's holding everything back, whatever your motivations are, you became the driving force of energy that pushed everything around you to be better and provided all of the wonderful things that your friends and family deserve. How amazing is that? To be able to find that in your life. That's really special. That's really something amazing. I can tell you from personal experience, there is nothing that feels better than being able to look in the mirror and realize that what you're doing is hard work that takes a lot of energy and takes a lot of time and a lot of mental clarity, and you're being successful with it. And as a result, the people that you love are blessed with the fruits of that labor, and they get to enjoy having the best version of you around. That's an amazing thought, and I think that's where I'm going to end this video. I really appreciate you guys watching. My links are down below. As always, if you love what you see here, you can support me with my Patreon or my Buy Me a Coffee link that are down below. You can go down to the shop, buy some Chris Cooking Nashville swag. You can join the YouTube memberships. There's an Amazon shop down there that I get a small commission off of when you guys use my link. There's all kinds of stuff, ways you can support the channel if you like what I do. And I rely on you guys to help us do this, because I could never afford this or figure out how to do any of this if it weren't for your support. It literally keeps us afloat in a very difficult world for musicians right now. So thank you guys so much for everything that you do. I love you guys so much. I hope this is helpful and I hope it's inspiring. And I really just wish the best for your lives every single day. Let me know in the comments down below what this means to you, if this means anything to you, and how I can work to make your lives better here with the whole Chris Cooking Nashville channel. Thank you for watching. This is Chris. Eat your meat, love your life, and I'll see you guys back in my kitchen for that next recipe that's a tool.